In the previous video, we finally made our car move, and now we are going to make it turn, improve on that, and play around with simple drift mechanics just for fun. So, let's start. There are two main ways you can steer a Raycast car. The first one is to completely fake out the physics. In this way, when the arrow keys are pressed, you directly apply torque to the car to turn it, and then put some forces to stop and control the car's drift. You also need to dynamically control how much torque is applied based on the car's speed, so it doesn't turn without speed. This method, while not realistic, is very commonly used due to how easy it is to adjust the drifting. But we are not going to use that. Instead, we are going with the second method. This one simulates how our real car physics work. So we just have to rotate the wheels and let the physics take over and turn the car for us. It works by applying forces on the wheel itself, based on how much the wheel is pointing towards the movement of the car. So here, when the wheels rotate, we apply the red lateral force to the tire. The more not aligned it is with the speed of the car, the yellow arrow, the higher this force. That is the direction the tire wants to resist movement, that it doesn't want to roll. And we can also apply the blue arrow force to calculate the wheel's friction to stop the car, instead of how we did previously. This way of applying forces is well documented in real cars. The red arrow force, for example, is called the cornering force, or side force. And we can find a whole graph showing this named cornering stiffness, which is the ability of the tire to resist deformation. This graph will show how much lateral force a real tire produces based on the slip angle, which is how many degrees the tire is pointing off the movement direction. And you can also find the same for what is called longitudinal tire force, which represents the blue arrow that is pushing backwards and resisting the rolling. In real cars, these graphs can change a lot due to the temperature, load, tire deformation, and much more. So while we won't get quite as precise, we are going to use some of the same principles to apply our forces. So let's get started. But first, let's fix the wheel rotation. You might notice that the wheels are the opposite of what we want. The big wheel is rotating faster than the smaller one. So in the wheel acceleration function, I got confused and made a mistake here. To make the wheels turn correctly, you just need to divide the velocity by the radius of the wheel. Now that's done, let's really start. First, let's remove our deceleration code. We'll make the car wheel stop the car with the simulated friction now, which makes it easier to adjust the grip over different types of terrains. And just so we are back to the default settings, let's re-enable the default linear damp, which will make the car lose velocity and stop with time. We can remove this damp just for the car in the rigid body later, if we need to. And let's not forget to remove the deceleration variable. Now, go to project settings, input map, and let's set the action, turn right, and turn left. Click on the plus button and add the A key for the left and D key for the right action. And you can also add the arrow keys if you want to. Now let's add a new variable called tire turn speed to tell how fast the tires turn in radians, and tire max turn degrees to tell how much our steering tires can turn in each direction. Create a new function called basic steering rotation that will turn our wheels. We then create a var turn input, which is the input.getAxis of the turn left and turn right actions. This will give us a value between -1 and 1, depending on how much each of the inputs are pressed. And we'll multiply that by the tire turn speed. And if we have any turn input, we rotate the wheels. So let's drag the front left wheel for now, and change its rotation.y to be clamp f of the current rotation plus the turn input times delta. And we clamp the values between the tire max turn degrees after converting it to radians. And then we do the same for the front right wheel. And if there is no input, we want to return the wheels to the start rotation. So we set the rotation.y of each wheel with the move toward function, moving it from the current rotation to 0 by the rotation speed. Then we just need to call the function in the physics process. And you can now use the turn keys to rotate the wheels. But right now, it doesn't do anything. And we are still hard coding which wheels need turning, which is not good, but we'll fix that later. To make the car turn, let's create a new function named doSingleWheelTraction that takes a Raycast wheel. And if the ray is not colliding, we return. Here's where we'll add the lateral and friction forces over the wheels. For this to work, it's important to have the wheels Raycast correctly rotated. You can check their local rotations by toggling the local transform button and selecting each Raycast. You need to have the red arrow pointing towards the side of the tire. Now back to our code. We can get the steer side direction, the local x-axis of the wheel, with the ray.globalBasis.x. the global tire velocity with our get point velocity of the wheel, and the steering X velocity, the local velocity of the tire X axis, with the steer side direction dot dot product of the tire velocity. Now that we have all the information we want, we will also declare an X direction of 1.0. This is going to be how grippy our tires currently are. Now, to properly calculate the lateral force, we need to remember a common physics formula, force equals mass times acceleration, which we can change to force.mass times the variation of velocity over time. So to get our force, we need to calculate our desired acceleration, which is the lateral velocity of the wheel times our grip x direction divided by delta time. And our x force is going to be minus the steering side direction times the desired acceleration times the mass divided by 4, the number of our wheels. The mass in the formula is the tire mass that represents the load of the car the tire is supporting. So if you want to get really precise, you could probably use the spring compression and the center of mass to try and figure out the exact dynamic mass needed, but that's a bit overkill for our simulation, and the results are not that much different. In fact, we don't even need such physics-intensive calculations. We just need to have some value that loosely gives us lateral forces based on how the wheels are turned. So I ended up using a different value that I found works quite well. So my X force is actually minus the steering side direction times the steering X velocity times the weight, the mass times the gravity divided by 4, the amount of wheels. And we can get the gravity from the project settings with project settings dot get setting default gravity. Now all that's left is apply the forces. So just like before, our force position is the wheel global position where we want to apply the force minus the rigid body global position. And call apply force passing the X force and the force position. Then you can call a debug draw if you have one to draw the force arrows. Now we just need to call our new function with the others in the physics process. And our car turns. But if we fully accelerate, it flips. There's a couple of reasons for that. One reason is that our wheels are turning really fast and really far at high speeds, making the sudden change in forces very drastic. Another reason is that our back wheels are bigger and we are using them to accelerate, making it easier to flip. So if you select the back wheels and disable the ease motor and select our front wheels, making them accelerate instead, the car is now much harder to flip. But let's go back and make it drive from the back wheels again. To fix this flip problem, select all of the wheels and let's give them the slightest bit of overextent. This will extend the spring raycast and push our car towards the ground, making it harder to flip. And now, our car is almost impossible to flip. Even at high speeds, you need to try really hard to make it roll. You can play around with these values and make the car feel the way we want to, making it impossible to flip, or more realistic and prone to flipping at high speeds. You can also improve the wheel turning and make it turn slower at high speeds. This way, it will feel more realistic and will not flip the car as easily. But this all depends on what type of game you want to make. Another change you can do is instead of applying a lateral force to the wheel's local x-axis, you apply it directly to the car's local x-axis. You can do that by using the minus global basis.x. This is less realistic, but it will make your car turn much more responsively. This way, you have more control in adjusting the handling of the car and compress the springs more while turning. It might be a good choice for some types of arcade racing games. But let's undo that and go back to our realistic forces. And now, let's add friction to our wheels, which is by applying a local z-force towards the back of the tires. We can get the tire local forward direction with minus ray.globalBasis dot dot product of the tire velocity. And we declare the z-traction of 0.05, how much traction each wheel has. And our final z-force is the global basis dot z times the f-velocity times the z-traction times the tire weight. You can also use the ray.globalBasis.z here instead of the car's global basis to a more realistic traction force, which can affect the handling depending on how the wheels are steered. But I'm going with the simpler approach here, of just reducing the speed in the car's direction. Then, like before, we call apply force, but this time with the z-force. Now our car stops. Faster anyways. But because we are now fighting with attrition, our car will accelerate slower. So you need to adjust the acceleration if you want to keep the same speeds as before. Now you can use the type of terrain the tire is on to adjust the z-traction. But we'll play with that later. Our turning is still very far from realistic. So we'll fix that. But first, let's try to add a handbrake action to our car and make it drift. and we'll use the space key for that. We'll add a new variable called handbrake and set it to false. And in our input function, we'll check if the handbrake action is pressed, and if it is, we set the handbrake action to true. When it's released, we set it to false. Now here's what we are going to do. When we press the handbrake key, we'll change the X traction value to a smaller one, and that will make the car drift. So if the handbrake is true, we set the X traction to 0.1. And I'll also show a yellow arrow to show the direction the car is moving. Now let's try some drifting. It works, but when we release the button, the car jerks really aggressively. That's because it goes from very little force to a sudden high force. If you decrease our normal traction to 0.7, it's a little better. And reducing it even further to 0.2, now it's almost not there. To fix that, and make the car behave more realistic, we are going to use curves to control how our traction changes dynamically, depending on the slip angle. Let's go over our wheel script, and add a new export variable called grip curve, of type curve. This curve will represent how much grip the tires have. If you remember the cornering stiffness graph, the slip angle is used to tell how aligned the tire is to the car's speed direction, and the lateral force applied changes based on that. So let's start at 100 grip, and then lose almost all the grip at the end. Let's copy this curve and paste it in the other wheels. With these grip curves, you can change how your car handles and drifts by giving each wheel a different grip curve. Now let's go back to our car and make it work. We'll get the grip factor, the x value on the curve, by getting the absolute value of the lateral velocity divided by the velocity's length. And our x traction is now the ray.gripcurve.samplebaked of that. And now things are a bit better. But we still got some strange behavior. We can probably play around with the curve values and try to improve that. And talking about that, be careful when changing these values. Changing curve values does not work with multi-select. You might think you changed all of them, when in fact you changed just one. One thing you can do is copy the curve and paste it over the others. This will make the paste curve a reference of the original one, so when we change one, all of them will also change. And if you want to make them different again, you can use the Make Unique option. But anyways, with this new curve, now the car's light is way too much. So let's adjust that a bit. Now, things are not perfect yet. And one reason for that is that the tires behave differently when drifting. But to help visualize things better, let's create some simple drift marks for the tires. Let's give the car a new node 3D and call it Skid Marks. And add a new GPU Particle 3D node. Now under the draw passes, create a new quad mesh. Click to open it, and let's make it face the Y direction, pointing up. And create a material. Now go back up and create a process material tool. And let's move it to the side so we can see it. We'll disable the gravity acceleration so it just spawns in place. Now when the car moves, it will keep creating these squares and they will become our skid marks. Let's go back to our draw pass material, enable alpha transparency, and in vertex color, enable use as albedo. This will let us change the color of the mesh with the particles. Now back to the particle, open display and create a new color ramp. Open the gradient, and let's make the mark black at the start. And it's still black at the end, but with less alpha transparency, making it vanish over time. Then let's set the time to 1.5, the FPS to 60, and the amount to 150. And now we got something that looks like skid marks. Disable emitting, and let's duplicate this 3 times. Inside our car script, let's create a new export variable, skid marks of type array of GPU particle 3D, and add them in the inspector. Now let's add an ID variable and pass it over to the wheel traction function, and increase it at the end of the loop. This is just so we have a reference of what skid mark belongs to what wheel. Finally, we are going to add a new isSleeping variable, and we are going to set it to true when we first enable our handbrake. Inside our wheel traction function, let's first position the skid mark at where the tires hit the ground, and that is just the ray.getCollisionPoint, and we move it just slightly up so it doesn't z-fight with the ground for the position. Then we rotate the skid marks to the direction of the car, with look at the current position plus the back direction of the car. Let's set the x traction to 0.01 to lose almost all traction, and if the skid mark is not emitting particles, we enable it, drawing the drifting marks. And to make the transition from the handbrake more smoothly, we'll check if the handbrake is released but the car is still sleeping, and set the X traction to 0.1. And if we are not pressing the handbrake and the grip factor is less than 0.2, meaning the velocity of the wheel kind of aligns with the car speed again, we set the e-slipping to false, and go back to our normal gripping curves, while also disabling the skid marks. Now the feeling of our car is much better, and the drifting feels okay. Another thing we can do is make the skid marks skinnier, so let's open the draw pass of our particles and set the X size to 0.6. And now it looks much better. There are better ways to make skid marks, but particle skid marks are very simple to make and they usually look okay at an angle. But that's it, our car can now steer and even make drifts. There are still a lot of things we can improve and fix in our car, but the basics are all here. Usually games use two grip curves, one when driving and another grip curve for when the car starts sleeping. But we already got so many curves in this tutorial that I used a simpler approach here. Our lateral force calculations here are a bit problematic too. The corner stiffness usually tapers off at very low slipping angles. But in our code, the lateral force curve only maxes at 90 degrees, which is not ideal. And we are also using a variable force depending on the speed of the car instead of just the angle. So if the car is really fast, the forces are really extreme. And that is one of the biggest reasons of our problems. So we can probably improve on that. In the next video, we'll tie everything together, fixing a few problems and cleaning up the code. Then, we'll finally set our car with a proper car mesh. And if there is time, we can talk about a better way to turn the wheels, that is better to prevent slipping. As always, if you want to, you can check the project files by supporting me on Patreon. But that's really it. You now have all the tools to play around and start making your own car feeling the way you want it to. I hope you have fun making your games, and until next time.